All right, guys, it says it's streaming, so I should be good to go. I don't have a lot of percentage in my computer, but this has been bugging me and I had to come live because it's driving me nuts and I have to talk about this with you guys. So my name is Raven Woods and I am the CEO and founder of Autism Mama Rocks IEP. I help parents gain the knowledge and confidence to truly become the CEO of their IEP meeting, and honest to God, that is what I hope for every single one of you. So I'm super thrilled to be here with you today and to be coming live and doing these live streams. And I really hope that I help somebody just a little bit, if possible. The goal here is to really nail our IEPs. So many of us go through so much overwhelm and anxiety, and the more we know, the better. And the support that we have here and also on the group. So if you haven't joined the group, definitely do that, Autism Mama Rocks IEP group. And then also you want to grab the free checklist if you have not grabbed that. So today we're gonna talk about PLAAP and P-L-A-A-F-P. So that for those of you, I'm gonna pull up my phone. So just in case you guys ask any questions. So if you're new, post a two below, or actually post a one below. Post a one below if you're new, and post a two below if you're an oldie but goodie. Tell me hello, tell me where you're from, tell me about your child, and I'm so excited to have each and every one of you. My oldies but goodies know that I love them, and if you're new, join the group and join the club. We really are some awesome people, and it's such a way to network with other parents as well, and to really, really hone in on the fact that we're all going through different experiences, and the support and love that's here is pretty darn awesome. So thank you for that. So today we're going to talk about PLAAP, and we're going to talk about P-L-A-A-F-P, because it's been bugging me because, as many of you know, I'm getting ready to put out a course. I know many of you are really excited, as am I, but boy, is it a lot of work. But I was writing about this and I realized how different they actually are. So PLAAP is present levels of performance, and P-L-A-A-F-P is present levels of academic achievement and functional performance. Two different things, okay? So PLAAP is more the present level of where your child is now, and that goes into your IEP. So usually it's right at the beginning, okay? Somewhere in the beginning of your IEP that you have PLAAP, which is where your child is presently. I cannot emphasize to you how important it is to read that, because who knows your child best? What do I preach to you guys all the time? You know your child best, better than anybody in the whole world. You know your child, okay? I don't care what the teacher, and I'm a teacher. I don't care what the teacher's education is. I don't care what the speech therapist's education is. I don't care, because bottom line, nobody could prove to me that I know my child less than they do, that they know my child more and I know my child less. It doesn't work like that, right? As parents, we just know. And if we don't, we figure it out, you know, especially when it comes to our kids. You know, if we have to take our kids to the ER and they say, oh, nothing's wrong, but in our gut, we know something's wrong, what do? We figure it out, right? So it's the same thing. And, you know, I'm not saying that all teachers are bad or negative or anything like that. Nothing of the, I would never say that, okay? And being an educator, I think it's important to understand that most teachers teach because they love children. And a lot of general education teachers don't have as much input in an IEP if the child is not in the least restrictive environment and they're more in a secluded environment, you know? So that's something to definitely keep in mind. But moving back to PLAAP and P-L-A-A-F-P. So again, for those of you hopping on, post a one below if you're new, two below if you're oldie but goodie. Just tell me who you are, where you're from, tell me about your kids if you want to, and we'll go from there. But I love having new people, and you oldies but goodies know I love having you. So Present level of performance is plop. Okay. Present level of performance is where our children are now. As I was saying, it's usually in the beginning of your IEP. Please, please, please read that. Don't skip over it because it's just where your kid is now. And it has nothing to do with or what's in goals, et cetera, because let me tell you something. Plop is where you should be getting together what you want your goals to be for your child. I truly believe that as you gain the knowledge and confidence, which I hope to help you with, you can create your child's goals yourself. Okay. That doesn't mean that the team doesn't help you. So they provide the goals to you in advance. You review the goals, you compare them to PLOP, and you create goals that you believe are SMART. Okay. Which is specific, measurable, actionable, realistic, and time edited, limited. And you want to make sure that all goals go by that. Okay. I go into detail on that in my course, because if you don't know how to make SMART goals, that's a problem. Okay. And it, if you know how to do it to a T, which you will learn that, you will definitely learn that. However, it takes time and practice, and it's important to understand because all goals should be SMART. And if you get really good on making SMART goals, you are going to be the goal queen, king, whatever. Okay. So present level of performance, please, please, please read it and please understand it. And honestly, you know, if it's true or not, believe it or not. A lot of times what is written in the present levels of performance, where your child is now, is not always correct. I can't tell you how many times I have read where they say this, 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 and this about my child. And I'm like, no, she can't do that, you know, or I'm questioning like, is that something she really can do? Or like, I get confused at the fact that it's there, you know what I mean? So then I get angry and frustrated, and then I test her myself, you know? So don't be afraid to do that. And don't be afraid to have other people come in and test your child so that you know that if something is mastered, okay? Because a lot of goals, unfortunately, in a lot of IEPs that I have recently read with you guys, the goals are not SMART. And a lot of the goals are not specific, okay? And having specific goals, SMART goals, I will repeat what that means in a second, is crucial, okay? Because it's a way for you to be able to keep on top of the goals, and there be a end date, okay? Of this is when the child should have mastered this. That if the child, if you have down that your child is going to write three sentences, okay, so that's specific, right? Your child's gonna write three sentences. And then measurable is three sentences with only two mistakes with periods and commas, okay? And it's realistic based off of what you know they can do. Hopefully, I'm just giving you an example, okay? And time limited, so that your child will be able to do that by such and such date. Okay. So there needs to be very specific goals as to what they can do. It can't just be your child will hold a pencil correctly. You don't want stuff like that. You don't want stuff like my child will write five sentences. How, you know, how are they going to write five sentences? Are they going to write five full sentences? Are they going to have periods? Are they going to have commas? You know, you need to be very specific as to how that's going to look. Okay. Because if not, and your child can just write five sentences, and you can even put legible, you know, Skylar just came down from a shower. So it needs to be legible. That can be put in there, you know, that you can read it, or it can be that the lettering can be larger. So for example, if, you know, the lettering is, you know, just on a regular piece of paper, you know, regular paper, not the college rule, but the regular paper, then you can put that that's the type of paper that they write on, or it can be where they write on larger paper, or the font, if they're typing, can be larger, et cetera. You know, you want to make sure that these things are that specific. Okay. So I know we kind of went into goals, but the reason I went into goals is so that you can understand that the present level of performance is your starting point, baseline, so to speak, okay? Because this is where the school is saying, this is where your child is. So you need to not only figure out, is that really where your child is, but you also need to figure out where your child's gonna go. What goals do you want for your child to have to build off of where they presently are? Where do you want them to go? How do you want those goals to look, okay? So present level of academic achievement and functional performance. Let's talk about that for a second, okay? So that describes basically what level your child, I have my notes right here, where your child is working academically and functionally. So it's a little bit different. It's kind of what they're working towards versus where they're at. Does that make sense? So PLOP is where your child is at right this moment, okay? Which is present level of performance, okay? And if you have any questions, definitely post them below. I have this here. So if I need to, I need to turn it down, but yeah, I have you guys here. Hi, how are you from San Diego? Oh, what a beautiful, beautiful area. I love that. So definitely post your questions below if you have any questions. So present level of academic performance is where your child is right this second, okay? What the school is saying, this is where we see your child now, okay? So the present level of academic achievement and functional performance, which is PLAAFP, okay? And that describes really what levels at which your child is, not just academically, but functionally, okay? And it really kind of summarizes the current status of your child's educational needs, if you will, and the performance where there is need. Does that make sense? So Skylar, mommy will be with you in just a second, okay? All right. So basically you want to make sure you understand the difference, okay? Where your child is now is present level of performance. Where your child is functionally and academically, it's really more where they are working and not just where they are. So where are they working? What are they working towards? And then what is the need? Okay, so it's a little bit different in many different ways if you look at it accurately, okay? So one thing I want you to keep in mind is, you know, I always write notes before I talk to you guys because I like to stay focused, but I know that I will get off on other things because, you know, there's so much that goes into this. So I'm really trying to stay very, very specific to what I'm talking about. And tomorrow is content, which is Thursday nights at 8 p.m. So definitely come join us. I don't know what I'm going to talk about yet. I'm really trying to pick and choose. There's so many topics. When people join my group, I ask specific questions and I get a lot of my topics and content from that because that's based off of what you guys want and need and are requesting. So moving on, your performance areas, they kind of include like where your child is in communicating, okay? Where your child is on daily routine and activities, okay? Their intelligence, their general intelligence. It also includes their motor abilities, their sensory status. That also, sensory status is also vision and hearing for those of you who have children with special needs in that area. It also includes their social emotional, which really leads into behavior. And so this is more about the performance part in the areas of academic achievement and functional performance. Where are they performing and working towards? And then where is that need? Where are they needing help? Okay. Then the IEP team also considers, and you should definitely know about and consider, so listen up. You want to really focus, and I know this is a hard thing to think about, especially for those of you who have young children, but I cannot encourage you enough to focus on this early on versus later on, okay, which is transition. Okay, transition typically happens when the child is middle school. People sometimes say 16, but it's really more middle school to high school area. But even though your child is say 3, okay, you still want to be keeping that in mind, okay? Because the school system, based off IDEA, has to focus on that. They have to focus in helping your child become functional in their everyday living, okay? So everything that you're working towards is to help your child be independent, right? And if for some reason that's not at all possible, the goal is to get them as functional as possible, okay? And so transition is super important to keep in mind. And honestly, I encourage you to start placing that into your IEPs earlier rather than later, okay? We're talking small things, you know, like make things that are incorporated into ABA therapy, which is making a bed, okay? As simple as that, brushing their teeth. Little things like that can actually be incorporated into your child's services and accommodations, okay? Remember that an IEP is no one size fits all. Anything can go into an IEP, all right? So another thing is understanding the impact of your child's disability, okay? We talk about this a lot because one thing that I addressed today that I want you guys to know and understand, and I'm probably gonna repeat it a lot, is a lady had asked me, hey, Raven, you know, can you explain, I love what you do. What you do is awesome. It really helps us a lot. However, I'm a special education teacher and I wanted to understand why you say not to give the diagnosis to the school system, handing it over, okay, so to speak. So the reason, and I'm gonna repeat this again, the reason I say that is specifically because anything you hand over, email, et cetera, to the school system, all right, which you never not want to put things in writing, you want that paper trail. But anything you hand over, like a diagnosis, to the school becomes part of what's called their scholastic file, okay? And sometimes that it's not advised to give them and hand them over the diagnosis. Because what if it's something that they can overcome? What if it's something that you don't want them labeled forever? Another thing is to keep in mind is you don't just want to hand it over either, because a lot of times when you have a written out diagnosis, it doesn't just include the diagnosis. It actually includes a lot of personal information. Personal information that you don't necessarily want to give to the school system. Okay, so just focus on that and understand that just showing them at the IEP, the diagnosis, they can look at it as long as they want and read it right in front of you, because a lot of that personal information, they're not gonna, you know, retain at that moment, but you want to focus on them knowing that they were diagnosed by a clinician or a doctor and that information needs to be put into the IEP that your child was diagnosed with this. Okay. But you don't necessarily want to hand them over all your personal information because it doesn't matter anyway. Okay. And I know that sounds crazy, but your child's diagnosis does not matter in reference to special education. A lot of people will say, oh, it's going to help them get services and it's going to help them get this and that and the other. No, it doesn't. Your child's disability does not entitle them to any type of service and any type of accommodation or modification. Now, the impact of their disability does, okay? So you showing the school system, hey, my child was diagnosed with autism or ADHD or whatever, okay? You're basically saying, hey, here, you can look at this, but I just want you to look at it and document it right now here in the IEP. Okay, and make sure you record your IEPs and make sure that you are really focused on them documenting there in the IEP, because typically they're taking notes, that your child has a disability and that the disability is this, that they were diagnosed with this, A, B, C, or just A, whatever it is, okay? But I do not recommend you handing them that paper. It doesn't help anything. And the lady that asked me this, because I talk about this a lot and it's something she questioned because she's a special education teacher. And she said, but it helps me to understand. No, it doesn't, because you can go Google what autism is. You can go Google what ADHD is. You don't need my child's full diagnosis and write up. You just need to know that's what they're diagnosed with, right? So if somebody comes to you and says, hey, my child has autism and you wanted to know more about autism, you can Google it. Okay. But honestly, that's not going to give the teacher any more information by having that whole full diagnosis that has a lot of your personal information, your background, your child's background, all these different things. Some of that is important to have to and hand over to the teacher as far as like verbally, but they don't need to know all your business otherwise. Okay. Because the school system can retaliate down the line. And you want to protect yourself as best as possible. And like I said, handing them over a piece of paper saying, here's my child's diagnosis, does nothing other than going into your child's Scholastic file. And that's all your personal information as well. Versus showing them, handing over in the IEP, here's my child's diagnosis. They were diagnosed by Dr. So-and-so, et cetera. They document it right then and there. Done deal. Same thing. The teacher then knows your child has autism, cerebral palsy, whatever it is, okay? And if they need to know more about that disability, they can one, ask you, two, they can Google it, okay? And that's not difficult for them. So as a teacher to a teacher, I am responding to that question by saying, you, the teacher, do not need to have the paperwork from the parent saying what their child's disability is. You don't. You just need to know what that disability is. And you, the teacher, need to figure out, along with the parent and the team, what the needs are and what you need to do as the teacher to accommodate them. So again, you don't need to hand over your paperwork. There's no need for it. If you choose to do it, that's going to be a personal decision, but don't ever feel pressured to do it. You do not have to do it. They still have to document the diagnosis that they physically saw the paperwork. They do not have to have that in their hand, okay? So I hope I really got that clear. And again, it's like anything else as parents, it's a personal decision. I, having 13 years experience with this, along with having a child with autism and being an advocate for many years, I don't advise parents in doing it because they're still giving the information. They're still showing the information as proof. They're just not handing over all the paperwork and all the details that are in the paperwork that aren't just the disability, that are a lot of your background, your husband's background, your spouse's background, your other children's background, et cetera, because that's what they do in an in-depth diagnosis, okay? Especially if you go to a developmental pediatrician. So I don't recommend it, okay? That's the reason. So if you have any questions in reference to that, please message me. I encourage you to. I firmly stand by that. Again, it's a personal decision. And you get to make that. But people have asked me why I don't do that and why I recommend my clients not do that. And that is the reason. Okay. So that is in full why I don't recommend it. Okay. So let's move on to understanding what PLAAFP is, which is present levels of academic achievement and functional performance. We first talked about PLOP, which was present level of performance, which is where your child is right this second and what the school system writes about your child. You need to read that in detail. You need to make sure it's accurate. Test it out if you have to. Just make sure it is accurate. And if it's not, you need to make sure it changes, okay? Moving on to the present level of academic achievement and functional performance, like I said, has to do with also where they are moving towards and where the need is, along with the fact that performance areas are based off of not just academic, but communication, general intelligence, where they are as far as that's concerned, their health, mobilities, their sensory issues and status, where that's concerned, visual and hearing is included in that. And then it also includes social emotional, which also is linked to behaviors. And then transitions, okay? Transitions is transitioning into adult. It could be transitioning into post-secondary education. And the goal in special education from 3 years old all the way up to adult is to help them become as functional and independent as possible as adults, okay? That is the goal. And to hopefully have them be independent And the key things as far as academics that need to be focused on are reading and math, okay? So a big part of understanding these two areas that go into your IEP is understanding that I'm just gonna make it simple for you. One is where they are now, what the school system, not you, where the school system says, this is where your child, this is where we see them, okay? So read that, because if you don't, then what they say is accurate. And if it's not, then goals are not gonna work, okay? Because where your child is right this second has to do with how you plan out and make goals. And you need to be making those SMART goals, S-M-A-R-T, okay? Specific, measurable, actionable, realistic, and time limited, okay? And I'm gonna teach you in the course how to do that. However, you need to make sure that you read that plot, which is present level of performance. Because if you don't know where your child is right now, or they're saying where your child is right now, and you're saying, no, that's not correct, you need to make sure that's worked out, because the correctness needs to go into that IEP. If it's not correct, and you know for a fact that it's not correct, then you need to challenge it. You need to make sure you speak up and make sure that you handle that, because that's an important area that many parents ignore. So just make sure you do that, all right? Make sure that in the present level of academic achievement and functional performance, in looking at my notes, one of the questions that I got was, the school professionals see your child, believe it or not, in a different light than you do. They don't look at your child in the loving, understanding, parental way, okay? And many times children will do things for different people and not for others. So understanding and knowing that is important, and understanding knowing that they can do it is important, okay? Because that needs to be taken into consideration. And then one, it can be somewhat stated that it is mastered, but then comments that it's only mastered with certain people, that it still needs to be worked on based off the fact that mastery has to do with being able to do it with anyone that requests them to do it, okay? So that's important to remember. And for preschool children, it's important to really focus on, you know, where you're wanting them to get, and if at all possible, they can really succeed and move forward quickly based off their disability, depending on what it was, and possibly really be completely in inclusion, and there not have to be any type of special education, that it could just be possibly accommodations depending on your child's disability. So those are other things to really take into consideration, and make sure that you always, 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 if you haven't gotten it, download my evaluation and IEE guide, because evaluations should be done each year. However, it's mandatory that they're done every 3 years. So if you know anything about the evaluations, you know that triennially, am I saying it right? That it has to be done every 3 years, okay, by law. But I suggest it to be done each year, so you really know every year your annual where your child is, okay? And it's something to really compare things to then create different goals. And remember, I always tell you, have your IEPs quarterly, because if you don't, then you kind of lose sight of where you're wanting your child to go. Does that make sense? So if you have your IEP every year, there's so much time that's lost that you could be on top of goals, adjusting them, changing them, changing where they are. The time limited aspect of it can change a little bit. How specific they are can change a little bit. So it's important to quarterly have IEPs just to change up goals, address any issues. And then your annual is more your big kind of core IEP. But the others are basically going over goals, any issues that were a concern. And it's also a way to avoid that issue of school systems not providing you progress reports, which is another issue that a lot of parents are having. is they're not provided progress reports, which you're supposed to be provided with progress reports every, as much as other children, typical children, if not more, depending on their disability. Okay. So it's important to really understand that and understand that your child is able to really succeed. That's the goal. Okay. And the goal is to also make sure that their present levels are where they need to be and where they really are at that moment, and then figure out where you need to go from there. And then looking at your present levels of academic achievement and performance and where they're moving and what the need is, so that you can really dive into your services, your accommodations, and anything else that is a concern. Okay, you need to bring this up. You need to find out where they are as far as functional living, and you need to also know where exactly they are. So it was bugging me today. I really wanted to come live and really have you understand the difference between the two, because they are different, and also have you understand that that's not a part you ever want to skip in your IEP. I know it's a lot. I know it's a lot of information. And I know that as we possibly get more comfortable in what they look like, it's an area that many kind of skim past, you know, because they're like, oh, that's not really important, or it's not something that I need to focus on. Because a lot of us will skip and go to accommodation, services, modifications, and goals, you know? And then I'm finding too that many people are struggling with what goals should look like. So that's a topic that I will be talking about, and how goals should be really written. But it's also going to be in the course coming up soon. Make sure that you guys, if you're open to signing up for the wait list, because I'm going to be having a very big free webinar with an amazing topic that I think you will love, and also a huge, 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 huge gift at the end. So definitely go on to Autism Mama Rocks the IEP and click on Educational Vault and get on the course waiting list. You will be one of the first to know when I'm having this free webinar. It's free. And huge gifts at the end. And it's going to be a pretty awesome topic, I think. And it won't take more than an hour of your time, and it'll be a good time. So definitely sign up for the wait list. And also, there's only a certain amount of spots that I have, and I know that there's a lot of people on the wait list now. So definitely get on it so that you get notice and that you can get onto this free webinar, because you're going to love it, I promise. So I will talk to you guys soon. I hope that you understand PLAAP and then PLAAFP. And if you have any questions, definitely post them below or message me, because it's important to understand the dynamics of each, what each really is, and how it can work for you in creating your SMART goals and understanding how to accurately create them so that your child continues to move forward, continues to make the proper progress, and make sure that you are clear of when those goals should be accomplished, should be finished, and should be mastered, and you're clear on that, versus getting to an IEP. There's nothing more frustrating than not understanding why the teachers are saying, no, they haven't mastered it yet. We're still working on it. How many times have we heard that? We're still working on it. Well, if you have something that's time limited that you all created as SMART goals, then that excuse should not be there. Now, there's times where that is going to be there, that it's normal and reasonable, but there's other times that it's not. And it's important to understand that aspect as well, which we will talk about in another live. So just understand how important this is. Focus on what it is. Go to your IEPs in the next couple of days and really look at that present level of performance. Where are they? Is it really where they are? Has it changed? Does it need to be changed? Let me know, post below. I will talk to you guys soon. Don't forget tomorrow, 8 p.m. right here on the page. We will be doing live content, and it's always great. It's always a good time, and it'll be good, solid content. So it's something you can take away, and hopefully you learn from it, and grow from it. And if there's mistakes made that you find out, oh, I did that and I shouldn't have done that, then that's okay. I'm very, very, very adamant at the fact that as long as you go back to the basics, you can always recoup what you lost. You can always recoup where you messed up and forgive yourself and move on. Don't worry about it. I know you're like, oh, I failed my kid. I'm not, you know, doing this right. I'm overwhelmed. I don't know what I'm doing. This really sucks. please help me. So it's understandable. Okay. So just take a deep breath, understand that you have the support. And if you have any questions, please let me know. You're welcome to sign up for the free discovery call to see where we need to lead you. And we'll go from there. Okay. So have a great, great, great New Year's Day. And I will talk to you guys tomorrow night. Bye-bye.